How many people feel, with so much information in the world today, that it's hard to keep up with everything you need to know just in a bunch of different areas? How many people feel like that? You know, if we were to ask parents today, how many of you feel really confident that you know what to do as a parent? A lot of folks are going to say, no, I'm not really confident. I mean, I turn to counselors, teachers, advisors. I'll, you know, do a Google search on different questions because I'm not really sure all the time what to do. It used to be that people actually knew what to do because they knew what God said. And so we want to go back to that today. And at the end of today, the end of our service this morning, if there's one desire that we have for you as a parent or as a grandparent, still trying to help your children and your grandchildren, it would be that you would say, I know what God wants. I know what I'm supposed to do. God has shown to me, and I know the most important thing as a parent. So when I say what is the most important thing as a parent, I want to give you a perspective. There's 1,189 chapters in the Bible. That's a lot of chapters. The Bible is a really big book. But if we were to find the one chapter that tells us the most and that is totally life-changing and will give us joy and confidence and direction from God, it's Deuteronomy chapter 6. I'll just say to every parent and every person here, this is the most empowering, informative, helpful, solid teaching in the entire Bible on parenting, from Deuteronomy chapter 6, and it is our privilege to look at it this morning and to encourage one another, and we're going to do it in the context of a baby dedication and the broader context of all of us being dedicated to the Lord and dedicating our children to the Lord. So I'd like to lead us in that regard in a prayer. Would you all bow your heads with me? Lord God, we come to you this morning in the name of Jesus Christ. And we dedicate ourselves, we dedicate this service, and Holy Spirit of God, we pray that you would move, not just in our minds, but in our hearts, that we would leave here today with a greater sense of being dedicated to you and of dedicating our children to you. We pray this in Jesus' name, amen. I'd like to ask Matt and Amy Walter, if you would come forward with Isaac, and also all of those of you who are here to stand with the Walter family this morning, and the elders of Harpeth Community Church, if you would come forward, please. And in fact, Matt and Amy, I'm going to ask you to come right over here with Isaac. Oh, look at this. He's beautiful. Yeah, come on up. A lot of family support here. You know, when Harpeth Community Church was first started, there was a very small student ministry, and it was initially comprised of Amy and her sister Sarah, who's over here. And so it's really cool that these 15, 16 years later, Amy is up here to dedicate her son here at Harpeth Community Church with the support of family and friends. And so we have family members, including grandparents. And we also have Kim Keith and Julie Jorgensen who are up here with them. And this is a good God-honoring thing because to raise children today, to follow the Lord, it requires a lot of folks helping us. In just a minute, I'm going to ask you, the congregation, to commit to do your part for Matt and Amy and Isaac. As we raise our children, it's going to require friends, brothers and sisters in Christ, oftentimes to step in and help and to love us and to love our children and to say just the right words to our children at just the right time. So I'm going to read this passage, and Matt and Amy, when I read it, I'm going to turn around to you and I'm going to say, do you agree to the things that it teaches? And then I'll say to the church, do you agree to help? And then Amy's father, David, is actually one of the elders here, and he's going to lead us in a prayer for Isaac. So Deuteronomy chapter 6, here's what it says. These are the commands and decrees the Lord your God directed me. This is Moses speaking. These are the commands and decrees the Lord your God directed me to teach you to observe in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to possess, so that you, your children, and their children after them may fear the Lord your God. When he says this, he says, I'm giving this to you, and I'm looking at Susan's parents right now who had the commands of the Lord, and those commands were passed on to Susan. If you'd raise your hand, Susan. And now those commands have come down to Amy and now to Isaac. That's God's plan, is that we would teach our children the commands of the Lord to the third and the fourth generation. He says this, so that your children and their children after them may fear the Lord your God as long as you live by keeping these decrees and commandments. Hear, O Israel, be careful to obey. And by the way, when he says, hear, O Israel, that includes you, and that includes me. Be careful to obey, that it may go well with you, and that you may increase greatly in a land flowing with milk and honey, just as the Lord, the God of your fathers, promised you. So as we begin, God says to us that we need to hold him in healthy respect, and we need to know that God can be trusted to take care of us, and he entrusts his word to us, asking us to respect him, respect his authority, and that will ultimately be best for Isaac. Matt and Amy, do you believe that?
Absolutely.
Yeah, I know you do. Now, God is going to say two things, and the two things are so important. The first is that you are to love God, Matt and Amy, with all of your heart, your mind, and your strength. And then coming out of the fact that you love God and God's commandments are on your hearts, coming out of that, then you're to teach Isaac these commands. And you do it through, we always call it this expression, intentional relational discipleship, which basically means that your intention is that this little guy will grow up to be a man who loves God with all of his heart, mind, soul, and strength for all of his life. And God's entrusted him to you through relationship, that you would disciple him and teach that. So it says this, hear, O Israel, again, love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. And as they're on your hearts every day, impress them on Isaac. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and of your gates. And I promise you, based on the authority of the Word of God, that you will be blessed, that he will be blessed, and that the children that Isaac has will be a blessing to you because you trusted God and you trusted his word. And when you doubt, don't doubt. Always go back and say, I have authority that is higher than any authority. It's the authority of God's word and his commandments. And we will walk in these commandments and we will teach Isaac to love God and to obey his commandments every day as you lie down, as you get up, and as you walk along the road. Matt and Amy, with God as your witness and your friends standing before you, do you commit to God that this is what you will do for Isaac?
Yes.
God bless you. And I say to you, Harpeth Community Church, those of you who make this your home, and as this is your home, we are bound in covenant relationship with each other to help each other follow Jesus and to help each other to help our children to follow these commands. So I say to you, Harpeth Community Church, will you do your part to help Matt and Amy raise Isaac? And if you will do so, signify by saying, we will.
We will.
May God bless you. I'd like to ask David Sanders to come forward and the elders to gather around Matt and Amy. If you'll come, in fact, move up just a little bit here. And if you all would reach out to Isaac with your hands to signify you're joining us in prayer.
I just want to thank you, Bobby, for such a beautiful dedication, and also to have all of my family here. It's really emotional. It's a legacy that we look at for all time, and we're looking at it. When the Bible talks about the fourth generation, it's really real. For those of you that have this example in your family, there's nothing that can there's nothing that can be greater to a father than to know that his children are followers, and then that their children will be followers. And so you're looking at generations here that are following Christ to the best of their ability. So let's pray. Father, you're just amazing. Your grace still amazes me. And Father, as I look at little Isaac today, I think, Father, I look at him as the man of God that he will become. And I thank you, Father, for his parents, for Matt and for Amy. And I just pray a special blessing on them right now that will go forward, that will last for Isaac's entire life, his time here on this earth, that he will be blessed by the people around him that know your son, Jesus Christ, that they will bring him up in the knowledge of your son. And that he'll go forth and be able to disciple others in your son's name. In Jesus' name, and we all said,
amen. 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 Let's give him a hand, everybody. Liz Enders from our children's ministry has a special gift that we always give to parents. And we're going to also have a gathering for parents who dedicate their children where Liz and Cam will be teaching you some more. God bless you. You know, as David pointed out, God's plan is that it would be multi-generational, that we follow God in communities. We follow God in family communities and in church communities. And it's a special weekend here for us at Harpeth Community Church because last night and then this morning and then tonight, we're going to have teaching that really is multi-generations. We're going to explain that. The young man who did communion a little bit earlier was once a little boy. In fact, we have a picture of when he was a little boy. We actually recreated the Passover feast, and that's me with my children when they were small. I want to show you a video clip now of a young man who 10 years ago, when the church was meeting in Hunter's Bend, and he was a budding songwriter, would go on to produce a lot of great music, but whose real heart's desire was to raise his children and influence churches and generations to raise their children to be dedicated to the Lord. His name is Jason Hauser, and as we began the service this morning, his son Brandon read for us from Psalm chapter 1. Well, 10 years ago, Jason and Heidi dedicated Brandon to the Lord. We want to show you a clip of that, and now Jason is going to take Deuteronomy chapter 6, if you'll keep it open, and he's going to show you practically how to put it into practice in your life every day. Let's watch this clip together.
Jason and Heidi, in bringing Brandon before the Lord this morning, let me encourage you that this is the greatest thing in your whole life. Your greatest ministry, your greatest work will be the dedication of yourselves and of your children to God. And I just exhort you and I challenge you now to remember that all the things you do in this world, this is the most important thing for you to be about. And I exhort you and I encourage you to have devotionals with your children on a daily basis. That as they get older, not only take them to Sunday school as you are now, but to continue to teach them at home. Help them to form friendships with other Christian families and Christian children. Parents who are raising their children with the same goal. I challenge you that when these children, and in particular Brandon, who is now being dedicated to God, that when he becomes a Christian, as I believe that he will, that you carry on and you realize the goal is not just to get him to believe, but the goal is to help Brandon and for your whole family to be dedicated disciples. So many people raise their children, and then when they believe, the parents give up. And it's like, okay, my child is saved, when they don't realize the real goal is that these children will grow up and be like Jesus Christ in all that they think, say, and do. And that you as parents are to set the example and to train them. And I say to your brother and his wife and your parents that your role is to pray for these children and to encourage Jason and Heidi. And this is not just a ceremony. This is real stuff. This is the real deal. And we call upon you to join with them as we as a church join with them in the dedication of this child. David?
Woo! All right. So this guy's grown a little bit. I told him, I said, can I try to pick you up in the, like I was holding you before? It's like, okay. It doesn't quite work. It's easy when they're little babies, isn't it? So, but it's amazing to see these guys grow up and be in a church family. And we watched that dedication. We were talking about this and been working on this book together. We remembered, it's like, wait a second, we have the video footage of that. My wife just recently got it put on DVD. And so it was cool to get to see that, to share that, how Bobby said to be dedicated. And I love at the end, he said, this is real stuff, you know. Little did we know, it's so real. All right, well, thank you, Brandon, for coming up here, bud. All right. Well, I can't tell you how awesome it is for me to get to be here with you guys this morning to share these things and what God has done in our family. And it's Jesus that's done the work in us. It's to him to be is all the credit. God puts us in church families, and I can't tell you enough for you here at Harpeth Community Church how blessed you are to have this church family. And please take advantage of it. God calls us to be a part of a church. We don't this place that we're in. This is a building. Okay, there's lots of buildings, but we are a church. Okay, and what the church is supposed to do in a believer's life is what this church did in our lives, is it took us out of being really in bondage and took us into a life where it's like, here's what God has for us. And we went through one of the most difficult periods of our life here at Harpeth, and we had Bobby and Cindy Harrington and David and Susan Sanders walk us through that time. And then what happened as a result of that, and when I finally said to the Lord, okay, God, my great plan didn't work. You know, and you don't have to get to that point in your life. Many of us do. But when you just say, God, you know what? And I said, music and everything. And I said, it's all on the table for you. And then God said, well, I have something for you. And that was the beginning of the Seeds Family Worship Ministry here at Vacation Bible School. And that was the beginning of this journey of discipleship, because it was coming out of that time with dedication time, this challenging season. But God brought us through, and he is faithful. Can everybody say amen to that? So I just want you to be encouraged this morning. And as we teach on Deuteronomy 6, what I want to do is take where Bobby began, and of course having this dedication this morning and having the Sanders family just and the legacy of God's work in their lives, that's a picture. We're a generation that we respond more to pictures than to words many times, and that's a picture of what it looks like. And I don't think they mind me saying that they're an imperfect family. A lot of people, you know, they look at this and they go, well, you know, I can't do that. And I'm not an elder in church. Or I'm not a pastor. I'm not this. It's every single one of us, you guys. We're all ministers of the gospel. Not just, some are called to be pastors, but every person is a minister. And Ephesians 4 talks about equipping the church. The job of the church is to equip you guys to go out and do the work of the ministry. Can everybody say amen to that this morning? I'd like to have a conversation. You know what I'm saying? I'm just not talk, and you guys sit there like, what? I mean, we're talking about stuff, right? And so, amen, thank you. And so as we get into, so let's go ahead. I want to just give you guys a picture of our family. My time is short, so I just want to ramp into this. But this, we call our family Hausermania. And when I heard the name of this mountain, I felt like we needed to climb it together. This is Bald Mountain that we're standing on top of. And so, bald men look good on Bald Mountain, don't they? I mean, hello. Okay, so anyway, but that's obviously that's me. That's my awesome wife, Heidi, and then our oldest son, Benjamin, and then Brandon, who you guys have met. And of course, you can see his style. You like that? And then our little girl, Abigail, coming out of the challenging season we went through, and God blessed us with her, and she has been just a continuous blessing. But we climbed that mountain. That's actually a 12,000-foot peak that we climbed in Utah with my brother and his family. But it's only about a mile and a half climb. But it is a pretty significant climb, you know, to get up there. And it's just like what we do with this Deuteronomy 6 passage. It's when you're climbing a mountain, and we love to hike together as a family, but it's just one step at a time. It's not getting everything right. It's not, there's no magic formula, but it's saying, you know what, we're going to make a commitment as a family to take this next step. And just one step at a time. And then you realize, and then, of course, and all of us can say as we get older, it goes by so fast. And before you know it, you're a part of a baby dedication. It's your child, and then it's your grandchild, right? And you feel like, boom, it was a blink of an eye. So anyway, so that's our family now, and that's our journey. So if we can click to a couple more slides over. Go ahead and go one more. So that the slide that said family worship, basically what this passage teaches is what family worship is. And a simple definition of family worship is seeking God first as a family. Everybody say that on the count of three. One, two, three. Seeking God first. And the second thing is worshiping God together. Let's say that. One, two, three. Worshiping God together. And so this passage really lays that out as we begin. So if you have Deuteronomy 6 open, we're going to roll through this. I'm going to apply it to our lives. But it starts and it says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." And as Bobby said earlier, when it says, "Hear, O Israel," that means hear the people of God. That's us, God's children. If you are a follower of Jesus, you are a child of God. You are his child. Can you say amen to that? That's what I'm talking about. And so it says, "The Lord our God, the Lord is one." Here's where I want you to start in your household. And there's so much humanism in our culture, and the Bible is so clear on this. There is only one God. Jesus said in John 14:6, "I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me." So if you're a Christian, if you're a follower of Jesus, Jesus is the only way. You'll hear many times, you know, I believe, you know, people will say, and you hear this all the time, you hear this, people that are professing Christians will say this, "Well, I'm a Christian, but I believe that God's on top of a mountain. And there's many ways to the top of that mountain. And this is the way for me to get to the mountain." But that's not true. If you're a follower of Jesus, in the Bible, so many places, we could do a whole message on just that. But our God is not on top of a mountain. Our God came down to us. Jesus came down. He's been where we are. We don't earn our way. The other world religions, as Bobby teaches in Exploring Christianity, which is a great class if you want to learn more about this, but they say we have to earn our way to God. But we don't earn our way to God. Jesus made a way that what we can't do, and it's by grace we've been saved. So for your household that you say, "There's only one God. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." You start right here. That's the foundation. There is only one God, and you stand for that. And then it goes right here, and it says, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might." So that means for parents and grandparents, for everybody that has influence over kids. And by the way, if you're a member of this church, you may not realize this. You may be like, "Dude, are you talking to me? I don't have kids." You might be a teenager in here and be like, "Dude, I don't have kids, man. I'm a kid, right?" But guess what? You have kids because you're part of this church family, okay? And so for you to minister to the next generation, you have a place of influence. But it starts with you. You shall love the Lord your God. And so there's many ways to kind of break it down, and we try to avoid things, but it starts with you. And so you can say as a parent or grandparent, "Where am I with the Lord?" God wants to be in relationship with us. He doesn't want us just to know him. He wants us to love him with everything we have. And I tell kids at church camps when I'm sharing the gospel, I said, "Jesus doesn't want to be a part of your life. He wants to be your whole life. He wants to be the center of your life." Okay, so then go to the next slide. Deuteronomy 6:6 says, "And these words that I command you today are to be upon your hearts." Again, it's you've got to be seeking God in his word. So you've got to be loving him, and you got to seek him in his word. Can everybody say amen to that? Boom! And then the next slide says, "You shall teach them diligently to your children." And diligence is, it says, it's steady, earnest, and energetic effort. Okay? One word that we use a lot in the Seeds Family Worship Ministry is to be intentional. And one of the things that we talk about as we teach on family worship, as we travel with the Seeds Ministry, is what we call a family worship fingerprint. And we all have a different fingerprint. God made all of us unique. Every family is unique. Every family has unique struggles. Every family is dysfunctional. If you thought you were the only dysfunctional family, congratulations, everybody's dysfunctional. Feel good about that. Amen. Woo! So Everybody's imperfect, right? But we're all different. But what this scripture says is, how are you going to disciple your children and grandchildren? How are you going to do it? You've got your own fingerprint. And your family, you may say, you know, well, but my family's messed up, or, well, you know, I'm a single parent, or we've got a blended family, or, you know, we're struggling in our marriage, whatever that looks like, or both parents are working outside the home a lot just to get by. Well, God can work with that. God can work with that. So what are you going to do to be intentional? So I'm going to just break down a few ways where this scripture says, talk about them when you sit in your house. And so what does it look like to sit in your house? Playing card games, just talking, having meals together, which is so difficult. And you know, you don't have to do it every day, but it's just having a regularity that we're saying, we're going to sit in our house. Then the next verse says, when you walk, by the way. Now, we don't walk around a lot. What do we do, everybody? What do we do? We drive our cars, right? So you're driving, but you know, at that time, we waste so much time. I challenge you to turn off your cell phone. One of the things we did with our kids is we said on the way to school, which is like a 5-minute drive for us, we just read a proverb. And not every day, just sometimes. We're just like, hey, let's read a proverb. And we do that. And then we share what it means and how it will apply to their day. But we take that drive time and we use it to teach. And then the next one is when you lie down. And for our family, what we do is before bed, we take, you know, maybe 15 minutes. Again, it's not every day. We flow. We try to go 3 times a week. We try to have a time we sit down and get into God's word in some way. And sometimes it's discipleship, which is discipline. Some families call it punishment. I don't call it that. I call it discipline, okay? But sometimes it's like we've kind of gotten off the road a little bit, so we got to talk through some stuff, and that's our devotion time for that night. But we try to take some time before the kids go to bed to pray, say a short prayer, and to get into the word. And I can introduce you to many resources. Please come tonight for more. And then the next slide, this is a family. This is the Moreland family. And if you were here last night, Philip Moreland and his family, they do their devotion time in the morning. They're more structured than us. They eat breakfast together at 7 a.m. and every school day, they just have a short devotion time while they're eating their, you know, while they're eating their pops and their sweet sugar cereals. They're getting into the Word of God. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, and I said, that's great because your kids peak right when you're teaching the gospel. Then they get to school and they crash for their teachers. I said, you guys are amazing. Okay. So, but they do it when you rise. Okay. And so go to the next slide. And so this is our Hauser mania. And so it's like, how are we going to do what God's called us to do? And it's not us. It's God working through us. Okay. But you say, God, help us to teach these kids about you. Because there's nothing more important, as Bobby said this morning, than to help these kids follow Jesus. So I just want to finish our brief time together with a story. Don't put up that next slide yet. I'll tell you when. But we had a pretty serious accident. I don't know if some of you have heard about this, but with our boy Brandon, if you couldn't tell from a short time seeing him, is he's a lot like his dad, okay? And we get these ideas in our minds. We get these little pictures. I'm like, wouldn't it be cool if ... That's usually when something bad's about to happen, okay? And so my wife Heidi and I, we were getting ready to go to actually a high school reunion, and our family was going out to a cabin about an hour away from our house, and so their cousins were in town. So our kids went off with their cousins an hour away, and they were ahead of us, and then we were going to finish some things up and head out there later. Well, little did we know, they got some new four-wheelers at the cabin, and the kids got there. Got on the four-wheeler. Brandon jumped on. Wouldn't it be cool if... ... I was riding this four-wheeler with my cousin behind me. And so they just take off. No instruction. No supervision. They go. Like I said, he's a lot like his dad. It's all right. And so... But as he's cruising the four-wheeler, at one point he thought to himself, oh, we're going out on the road. I need to stop. And so what he thought was the brake, he hit the accelerator. And when the moment he hit the accelerator, he went across the street and he clotheslined a barbed wire fence and fell on the ground. My brother got him, put him in their van. He's driving to the hospital. He calls us. I could tell from that moment his voice is shaking. And he's like, Jason, Brandon's had an accident. We're heading to the hospital. You need to come meet us right now. And so we're praying. And you guys, we prayed like never before in our lives for our son. And we said, Jesus. And the thing about Brandon, I know you can tell, he brings so much joy to our family. And I can't imagine for a minute what it would be like for Brandon to not be with us. And so we prayed. So we took him in to the hospital. And I remember we met my brother right at the moment he got there. And so the door of the van opened. There's Brandon bleeding from his neck and from his eye. And I pick him up and I carry him into the hospital and hand him off to the ER docs. And they take him into the room. And feeling so helpless at that time, but just praying to the Lord and saying, Lord Jesus, please spare our son. And we were just the deepest fear that we had. And I'll show you. Okay, go ahead and go to that slide. But this is what happened, is with his eye, you can see, and it was a millimeter from his eye, and then on his and a millimeter from his jugular. He was that close, but he was able to walk out of the hospital. And go ahead and do the next slide there. Got a little neck brace on him. He's doing a little better. And then, of course, Brandon, he can always, you know, no matter what. Okay, go to the next slide. He can crack a smile no matter what's going on. I'm like, dude, you're amazing. And so what I want to say is, as we get ready to share this song to families, is we don't always make the connection between our physical and our spiritual, but the same importance of us crying out to God, that was a wake-up call for us, you guys, about the preciousness of the lives of our children and their spiritual lives. There's nothing more important. And I know we're busy. I know the challenges. I could share with you the struggles that we've had when we moved to Idaho, the financial struggles, and I can share with you the faithfulness of our God. But there's nothing more important, if you are a follower of Jesus, than for your children and your grandchildren, for the next generation to follow him. It's all about that. Can everybody say amen to that? And their spiritual lives are in the balance. They are born into sin, and they need us to show them the way. And the most influential voice in the life of a child are their parents and grandparents. You have, if you're a member of this church, you have a great partner in this calling. But it's not all, the church is not going to get it done without you. And you have to do these things at home. And it doesn't have to be hard or perfect or as structured as you might think. It just needs to be intentional. And so that's what we're encouraging to do. So there's a song that I was a part of writing with Matthew West called The Motions that I want to sing. And I just want this to be a meditation. I want you to think about your life and your family. And for those of you that don't have children, I want you to think about your role in this church to disciple the next generation so that we're not going through the motions, but that we're doing everything we can to be all that the Lord has called us to be. This might hurt, it's not safe, but I know that I gotta make a change. I don't care if I break, at least I'll be feeling something. It's just okay, it's not enough. Help me fight through the nothingness of this life. And I don't wanna go through the motions, and I don't wanna go one more day without your all-consuming passion inside of me. I don't want to spend my whole life asking, what if I'd have given everything instead of going through the motion? No regrets, not this time. Gonna let my heart defeat my mind. Let your love make me whole. Think I'm finally feeling something. It's just okay, it's not enough. Help me fight through the nothingness of this life. And I don't wanna go through the motions. I don't wanna go one more day without your all-consuming passion inside of me.
I don't wanna go through the
the motions. I don't want to go one more day without your all-consuming passion inside of me. I don't want to spend my whole life asking, what if I had given everything instead of going through the motions, going through the motions. Take me all the way. Take me all the way. Take me all the way. Take me all the way.
I think everybody here can identify with not wanting to go through the motions, but to really take God and to take our children and to take the things that God has given to us to heart. I have an agreement with that. You all agree with that? We are going to give you an opportunity now. If you would like to come forward to the altar here, we have modified our stage so that after our teaching times, we can invite people to come and bow down before God and make your commitments to God. To say, God, some of us are here this morning and you know you need a momentous break where you say, I need to tell God again that this is what matters most to me. At the same time, we're going to have the elders over here to my right. If anybody has any special decision or need where you need one of the elders and their wives will be to my right. And I'm going to set the example. During the next song, I'm actually going to be on my knees and just telling the Lord that I don't want to go through the motions. I don't want to live a life with regrets. I want to rededicate myself to Him and my children to Him.